thousands of followers left Jesus in the last chapter. He was left with the 12 disciples. These 12 heard Jesus' words. They saw his signs. They walked with Jesus in a personal way. Peter said, "We're not going anywhere. We know you are the Holy One of God. We believe." But there were others who dwelt with Jesus in a personal way. His brothers. Let's dive in. I'm in John chapter 7, verse 1, reading from the New American Standard Version.
After these things, Jesus was walking in Galilee, for he was unwilling to walk in Judea, because the Jews were seeking to kill him. Now the feast of the Jews, the feast of booths, was near. Therefore his brothers said to him, "Leave here and go into Judea, so that your disciples also may see your works which you are doing. For no one does anything in secret when he himself seeks to be known publicly. If you do these things, show yourself to the world." For not even his brothers were believing in him.
John's timetable throughout this gospel often centers around a Jewish feast. In chapter 6, it was the time of the Passover. Now, it's the Feast of Booths. So about 6 months have passed. John sets the scene by telling us that Jesus is in Galilee, his home, and he's with his brothers. Jesus' mother Mary was a virgin. She conceived by the Holy Spirit. So Mary was his only earthly parent, though he was raised by both Mary and Joseph. Mary and Joseph together had children. Matthew 13, 55 and 56. "Is not this the carpenter's son? Is not his mother called Mary, and his brothers James and Joseph and Simon and Judas? And his sisters, are they not all with us?" So Jesus is with his brothers. Now John also sets the scene by telling us that Jesus is unwilling to go into Judea because the Jews want to kill him. I don't think it's any coincidence that right after he tells us that Jesus' brothers said, "Leave here and go into Judea." They are at cross purposes. And this is interesting because his brothers have to know that the Jews are seeking to kill Jesus. In verse 25, people are saying, "Is this not the man whom they are seeking to kill?" People know. His brothers know. But instead of having a protective posture that says, "Yeah, you might want to stay here, bro. They're after you." They're saying, "Leave. Go into Judea where the wolves are." Why? They say, "So your disciples also may see your works which you are doing." They said, "For no one does anything in secret when he himself seeks to be known publicly." Really? People haven't seen his works? He's been doing them in secret? In chapter 5, Jesus healed the man who had been lame 38 years in Jerusalem at a feast. It caused a big ruckus that lots of people saw. In fact, by the next chapter, chapter 6, he had thousands of disciples. And thousands saw him multiply bread and fish and feed them. So it's not even clear why his brothers are saying he's been doing his works in secret. But I hear such a mocking tone in this. No one does anything in secret when he himself seeks to be known publicly. If you do these things, show yourself to the world. Seeks to be known publicly. They're speaking to Jesus' motives, as if he's doing all of this simply to elevate himself. It's as if they're saying, "You want to be known so badly, be brave, go into Judea, show off to the world." John gives us insight into their motives. For not even his brothers were believing in him. Continuing verse 6.
So Jesus said to them, "My time is not yet here, but your time is always opportune. The world cannot hate you, but it hates me, because I testify of it that its deeds are evil. Go up to the feast yourselves. I do not go up to this feast, because my time has not yet fully come." Having said these things to them, he stayed in Galilee. But when his brothers had gone up to the feast, then he himself also went up, not publicly, but as if in secret.
Remember when Jesus' mother wanted Jesus to do something when the wine ran out? Jesus said, "My hour has not yet come." Now he tells his brothers, "My time is not yet here." And again, "My time has not yet fully come." Jesus wanted his earthly family to know that he was operating on an entirely different level. He didn't operate based on the will or the whims of others. He did the will of the Father. In Matthew 12, when someone said his mother and brothers were waiting outside to speak to him, he said, "Who is my mother and who are my brothers?" Then it says, and stretching out his hand toward his disciples, he said, "Behold my mother and my brothers. For whoever does the will of my Father who is in heaven, he is my brother and sister and mother." So when his brothers say this to him in John 7, the first thing he does is note the distinction between them. "My time is not yet here. Your time is always opportune. The world can't hate you." His brothers were of the world. The world loves its own, but it hates me. And no wonder, since the god of this world is Satan. As Jesus draws these distinctions, he is basically saying, "I'm seeking to do the will of the Father. You are not." So he says, "You go up to the feast. I'm not going up because my time has not yet fully come." There will be a time when Jesus goes up to Jerusalem in a very public, celebrated way, just a few days before he is crucified. When the crowd hears he's coming to Jerusalem, they will take palm branches and shout, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord," while Jesus is on a donkey. But it's not time for that yet. So Jesus' brothers go up to the feast, and Jesus goes up after, but not in the way they suggested, not in a public way. He goes in secret. Continuing verse 11.
So the Jews were seeking him at the feast and were saying, "Where is he?" There was much grumbling among the crowds concerning him. Some were saying, "He is a good man." Others were saying, "No, on the contrary, he leads the people astray." Yet no one was speaking openly of him for fear of the Jews.
The scene switches to Jerusalem, and we see the division that's happening among the people on account of Jesus. But no matter which side they're on, they're looking for him. Continuing verse 14.
But when it was now the midst of the feast, Jesus went up into the temple and began to teach. The Jews then were astonished, saying, "How has this man become learned, having never been educated?" So Jesus answered them and said, "My teaching is not mine, but his who sent me. If anyone is willing to do his will, he will know of the teaching, whether it is of God or whether I speak from myself. He who speaks from himself seeks his own glory, but he who is seeking the glory of the one who sent him, he is true, and there is no unrighteousness in him."
So Jesus shows up, and he doesn't do a sign. He just begins to teach. And even that is astonishing. Even when he was 12 and he was in the temple listening to the teachers and asking questions, everyone was amazed. Now he's the teacher. And people are saying, where did he get this? A key phrase throughout this gospel is, he who sent me. Jesus constantly refers to the Father and gives glory to the Father. And he gives this truth. If anyone is willing to do his will, he will know of the teaching, whether it is of God or whether I speak from myself. That's a promise to hang on to. If you want to know truth, God will be faithful to let you know if what you are hearing is of God. His Spirit will bear witness. Jesus continues, verse 19.
Did not Moses give you the law, and yet none of you carries out the law? Why do you seek to kill me? The crowd answered, you have a demon. Who seeks to kill you? Jesus answered them, I did one deed, and you all marvel. For this reason, Moses has given you circumcision, not because it is from Moses, but from the fathers. And on the Sabbath, you circumcise a man. If a man receives circumcision on the Sabbath so that the law of Moses will not be broken, are you angry with me because I made an entire man well on the Sabbath? Do not judge according to appearance, but judge with righteous judgment.
Jesus confronts them head on for wanting to kill him. And the crowd acts like he's crazy. You have a demon. Who seeks to kill you? Back in John 5:18, after Jesus healed the lame man on the Sabbath, it says, for this reason, therefore, the Jews were seeking all the more to kill him, because he not only was breaking the Sabbath, but also was calling God his own Father, making himself equal with God. That's why Jesus brings up the Sabbath here. Back in the time of Abraham, God had them circumcise their sons, and they would circumcise on the eighth day. Sometimes that fell on the Sabbath. And sure enough, they would circumcise their sons on the Sabbath. So Jesus is saying, you'll do that to keep the law of Moses, but you're angry with me for making an entire man well on the Sabbath? He's saying it doesn't even make sense. Judge with righteous judgment. Continuing verse 25.
So some of the people of Jerusalem were saying, is this not the man whom they are seeking to kill? Look, he is speaking publicly, and they are saying nothing to him. The rulers do not really know that this is the Christ, do they? However, we know where this man is from, but whenever the Christ may come, no one knows where he is from.
Division is highlighted throughout this chapter, first between Jesus and his brothers, then those who said Jesus was a good man, and those who said he was leading the people astray. Now there's division as to whether he is the Christ. You can just hear the murmuring in the crowd as people say, isn't this the man they wanted to kill? He's out here teaching and taking people to task, and no one's doing anything. Do the rulers think he's a fraud or not? Why aren't they doing anything? Is he the Christ? But no, we won't know where the Christ is from. We know where this man is from. They're confused even about prophecy. Some thought the Messiah would appear suddenly, but his birthplace is in Scripture, Micah 5:2. But as for you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, too little to be among the clans of Judah, from you one will go forth for me to be ruler of Israel. His goings forth are from long ago, from the days of eternity. Jesus grew up in Nazareth, but his birthplace was Bethlehem. Continuing verse 28.
Then Jesus cried out in the temple, teaching and saying, you both know me and know where I am from. And I have not come of myself, but he who sent me is true, whom you do not know. I know him because I am from him and he sent me. So they were seeking to seize him, and no man laid his hand on him, because his hour had not yet come. But many of the crowd believed in him, and they were saying, "When the Christ comes, he will not perform more signs than those which this man has, will he?"
So Jesus uses that phrase again, "He who sent me." And they know he's talking about God. And he throws in this other truth, "whom you do not know." These are the people who prided themselves on their relationship with God. But Jesus knows their hearts. And he adds on top of that, "I know him because I am from him and he sent me." Oh, they really want him now. They want to seize him and silence him, but they can't do it. His hour has not yet come. They are working on God's timetable. Nobody will touch Jesus until the time God has ordained. But look at that glimmer of grace in verse 31. "But many of the crowd believed in him." Jesus' teaching was bearing witness. Continuing verse 32.
"The Pharisees heard the crowd muttering these things about him, and the chief priests and the Pharisees sent officers to seize him. Therefore Jesus said, 'For a little while longer I am with you, then I go to him who sent me. You will seek me and will not find me, and where I am, you cannot come.' The Jews then said to one another, 'Where does this man intend to go that we will not find him? He is not intending to go to the dispersion among the Greeks and teach the Greeks, is he? What is this statement that he said, 'You will seek me and will not find me, and where I am, you cannot come'? Now on the last day, the great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried out, saying, 'If anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scripture said, from his innermost being will flow rivers of living water.' But this he spoke of the Spirit, whom those who believed in him were to receive. For the Spirit was not yet given, because Jesus was not yet glorified."
So the crowd is in a frenzy. The chief priests and Pharisees are plotting to seize him. And Jesus says calmly, "I'm only with you for a little while longer. Then I go to him who sent me." But look what he does. On the last day of the feast, he stands and gives an invitation. He's already said that soon they will seek him and won't find him. So he says, "Now, right now, anyone who is thirsty, come to me and drink." Jesus was actually using the water drawing ceremony that takes place on the first day of the feast and applying it to himself. It was a big ceremony with a parade by the high priest who filled a golden pitcher with water from the pool of Siloam and carried it back to the temple through the water gate. With a trumpet sounding, he entered the temple and poured the water from the pool into a silver basin. The water symbolized God's provision of rain for the crops. Such rain was precious in the Middle East. In the midst of this ceremony, Jesus stands and proclaims that he is the source of true water, living water. He told them to drink. How do you do that? He tells them how. Believe. He who believes in me, from his innermost being will flow rivers of living water. Very similar to the words he spoke to the woman at the well. John gives us the meaning that he's talking about the Spirit of God. When we believe and are saved, we are given the Holy Spirit who indwells us, who makes us alive, makes us new creations. Jesus says it's like rivers of living water flowing within. So amazing. Imagine being in that crowd hearing these words from the Savior himself. Continuing verse 40.
Some of the people, therefore, when they heard these words, were saying, "This certainly is the prophet." Others were saying, "This is the Christ." Still others were saying, "Surely the Christ is not going to come from Galilee, is he? Has not the scripture said that the Christ comes from the descendants of David and from Bethlehem, the village where David was?" So a division occurred in the crowd because of him. Some of them wanted to seize him, but no one laid hands on him.
Now we see that some in the crowd are remembering that the Christ would come from David and from Bethlehem. The problem is they apparently don't know that that's where Jesus was born. They're like, "He's from Galilee." Jesus was only born in Bethlehem because Mary and Joseph, both descendants of David, had to travel there from Galilee to register for the census. But that's when she went into labor. Of course, God is sovereign. But here's the thing, the scriptures spoke of Galilee as well. Isaiah 9, 1 and 2, "But there will be no more gloom for her who was in anguish. In earlier times, he treated the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali with contempt. But later on, he shall make it glorious. By the way of the sea, on the other side of Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The people who walk in darkness will see a great light. Those who live in a dark land, the light will shine on them." Continuing verse 45.
The officers then came to the chief priests and Pharisees, and they said to them, "Why did you not bring him?" The officers answered, "Never has a man spoken the way this man speaks." The Pharisees then answered them, "You have not also been led astray, have you? No one of the rulers or Pharisees has believed in him, has he? But this crowd, which does not know the law, is accursed."
How funny is this? Earlier it said they were seeking to seize Jesus, and no man laid his hand on him because his hour had not come. What did God do to prevent them from laying a hand on him? He made them spellbound. They simply listened to Jesus and were amazed. Never has a man spoken the way this man speaks. The Pharisees are outdone. They're clearly the only ones who have any proper understanding. Everyone else is ignorant and accursed. But one of the Pharisees speaks up. Continuing, verse 50.
Nicodemus, he who came to him before, being one of them, said to them, "Our law does not judge a man unless it first hears from him and knows what he is doing, does it?" They answered him, "You are not also from Galilee, are you? Search and see that no prophet arises out of Galilee."
It was brave of Nicodemus to speak here. The atmosphere is tense. They want to seize Jesus and can't. His fellow Pharisees just said that the crowd didn't know the law. So Nicodemus uses the law in defense of Jesus. "Our law does not judge a man unless it first hears from him and knows what he is doing, does it?" The Pharisees don't acknowledge whether Nicodemus is right about that. You can just hear them sucking their teeth. "You're not from Galilee too, are you? No prophet is coming out of Galilee." The Pharisees apparently were ignorant of the scriptures as well, not knowing the significance of Galilee. As for Nicodemus, Jesus had told him that the Spirit was like the wind. You won't see where it came from or where it's going, but it's evident the Spirit is working in Nicodemus. Let's go back to verses 37 and 38, where Jesus said, "If anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scripture said, From his innermost being will flow rivers of living water. This is a clean study because we want to grow closer to the Lord as we study this book of the Bible. And what we really need to know, what we really need to remind ourselves of, is that he wants us to cling to him. He gives us the gracious invitation. Jesus says, come to me. And it's not a one-time thing. You may have received Jesus 30 years ago and still come. Keep coming to him. Keep abiding in him. Keep clinging to him. Jesus said, from his innermost being will flow rivers of living water. Living water. His spirit within us is living. We have a living relationship with the Lord. That's rich relationship right there. And it's ours in Christ. Today, come to him. Dwell in the Lord's presence. Talk to him. Cling to him. Enjoy the living relationship the Lord has given you.